Hola, we're on here a little bit early, but we'll wait for some people to join now.
Should we close this curtain or?
Anyone here with us? Are you live?
Is it still bright enough or is that too dark?
You can see us better. Yeah, you can see us better now. Yeah.
Can we just clean this?
Okay, yeah.
Sorry, guys. One sec. Hi. Thanks for joining, everyone. We're so sorry about that last minute change to those of you who thought that it would be an hour later. We're kind of struggling with time zones, like both with our computers and kind of in general in life, because we've moved so many time zones in the last 2 weeks. So apologies. And if you were able to make it anyway, we're so happy you're here.
Yeah, hey guys. So yeah, I guess my computer when I set the live stream was set to Arizona time still or something. So
no, it was Tijuana time.
I don't know what happened, but we just realized 40 minutes ago that we had the wrong time zone, but that's fine.
Obi and Lori are here. Hi guys.
So any of you guys in Annapolis right now who are gonna be at the boat show watching this?
Hi mom. oh, Liverpool. Wow.
It was a Bud Light, whoever asked me. I think OB asked what beer. Not a very good beer.
Chicago.
But.
Hi, Matt. Yeah, the energy right now is super, like, electric. We're right now, we're in Annapolis, and we are staying at our good friend who runs the YouTube event for the boat show. So we're staying at his house. There have been people milling around all day, but right now it's quiet. So if anyone pops in the next hour, we'll definitely let them come in and say hi. I know Taylor's supposed to arrive today from Taylor's Travels. I don't think there's any more Tuesday people. Brian and Kaz will be back later. But anyway, so like a bunch of us are staying in the house, and then there's properties kind of like on this street that other people will be staying in. So One Life is going to be staying down the street. And then at the end of the street, there's going to be a bunch of RVs. So I'm just looking outside. So yeah, the energy is awesome here right now because it's just so much fun to see old friends and then meet new YouTubers because we all obviously have a lot in common. So exciting times here.
Oh, One Life's on. Hey, One Life, what's up?
One Life's
on. We'll see you guys tomorrow.
Hey, I thought you guys were supposed to be babysitting.
Brooke and Gary not paying attention to the baby.
Hi, Brooke and Gary. I can't wait to see you guys. Jacksonville, Florida, or you just watched the canal video. Awesome.
Hey, Devin. Devin's there too.
Devin? No way.
So what are we?
Hi,
what,
Devin.
So we just came back from, we left the boat. The boat is out of the water, for those of you who don't know. We made it all the way to top of Sea Cortez after the last hurricane. We had a little bit of cruising, maybe a week, and then we took off for the top of the Sea of Cortez. Calico Skies is out of the water at Penasco Boatyard.
Yeah. So we, over the last 2 months, I'm not sure where you guys are with videos. We basically, I guess over the last 3 months, we made our way from Costa Rica to the very top of Mexico. And it took a very long time because we had a lot of bad weather. And then we got COVID in the middle too, which is coming up very soon on our videos. I think next week, but, yeah, we were kind of just moving very slowly. And the bottom line is that in the last, like, oh, this, you guys got to meet Jeff. This is
Hello.
The man. This is the guy.
The man, the myth, the legend.
Yeah.
Really? Thank you.
Enough of him.
Yeah. We're all actually.
Nothing to see here.
We're all here because of Jeff Bock. So, yeah, we owe him a lot. Last year, there was 20 YouTube channels in the show. This year, there's 49 or 51.
54 YouTube channels.
And he manages that all. And we're in his house right now, too. So he. Oh, yeah. Do you guys want to see the schedule?
You want to see the organization level that's going on back here?
This is the Thursday
schedule. This is what's happening Thursday.
Yeah. So this way we can keep track of which channels.
Where are you guys?
Oh. Yeah. It's backwards.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's true. Sorry.
Anyway, so what was I saying?
The boat's in Mexico. Back to Mexico.
The boat's in Mexico. But what I'm actually trying to say is that for the last like 3 months, we basically got like, I think 4 weeks of actual cruising, like on the hook where we were swimming and doing cruising type things. So it's just been a lot of travel, which is important because we actually did have to escape a hurricane because we weren't quite far north enough, but we are now. And yeah, so now if for those of you who are like kind of know Arizona and stuff, like we're in Peñasco, Mexico. That's where Calico Skies is, but it's also known as Rocky Point. So it's a 4-hour drive to the border. And my family, my mom and my sister live in Scottsdale, Arizona. So 2 weeks ago now, we left Calico, drove over the border with some really nice people and stayed with my mom and my sister for a week. And then we went to New Orleans to hang out with our really good friends that we actually cruised with when we first quit our jobs 7 years ago. They were our very first buddy boats. And if you watch our old videos from like 2019, like our early videos, you'll see Chris and Michelle in those videos. They're the sweetest people. And we'd never been to New Orleans. That was awesome. So that's the catch up. And so we got in, went to a Killers concert last night with Jeff and Cam. It was awesome. We actually just found out that Will's cousin, I call him Will, it's a whole thing. Bill's cousin actually was at the concert. She drove up from North Carolina.
Yeah, no idea. My cousin was there.
We had no idea. But anyway, so we got in really early yesterday morning to Annapolis, and we're here for the next week.
Yep.
So
any questions from you guys while we have a break here?
Hi from Paris. Wow. Nap time. Oh, nap time. Yeah. I get that one. Is it Brooke or Gary? I feel like it's Brooke. Hi from Vermont. Oh, the colors of the trees. Oh, man. Fall is such a beautiful time. Hey. Hi, Carol.
That's one life question. So what are we going to do next? This is a big question.
Yeah. Oh, Jim. I can't wait to see Jim. Molly's here, too. Oh, that's Grace's my sister. Hi, Molly. Oh, my mom says she loves the chickens. My mom's on. Jeff has chickens in his yard. Okay, so plans. Don't want to disappoint you guys. I know we do every time we talk about plans, but the truth, if we're going to be honest, which we have to be honest, because that's the point, right? So we don't know. We don't know, but we thought it would be interesting to talk about why we don't know. And so for those of you who are cruisers or who've been cruising or even watch our videos and kind of have figured this out by now, but we live our lives very much according to weather. So both like on a micro level and a macro level.
That's a good point. Yep.
So whenever we're going to do passages and stuff, like long passages, we consult the weather because we can only do those at certain times of the year. It's based on like historical data. Then like, I guess maybe on a micro level, like our day-to-day lives in terms of like anchoring and that kind of stuff is also ruled by the weather. But anyway, so when you make long-term cruising plans, you have to look at like where you should be at certain times because yeah, the globe has like bad weather everywhere at all different times. We want to cross the Pacific Ocean. That's our next big journey thing. We haven't crossed an ocean
Since 2019. But the mileage that we're looking at is we just sailed 3,000 miles upwind and up motor to get to where we are. So the next crossing isn't like longer than we've done, but I think the challenges of being that far geographically are what's making us think about it a little bit more.
Well, yeah. And so just to back it up even a little bit more, but yeah, that is going to be where I'm going next. So we haven't crossed an ocean since 2019, and crossing oceans is very different than even like a week crossing, like the one that we did from Costa Rica to Chiapas. It's very enjoyable in a different way because you really get into the rhythm of the ocean. So we want to do it. But yeah, so the thing with crossing the Pacific is it's not so much that it's a longer passage than we've ever done. Our crossing back from Gibraltar to the Caribbean was 27 days, so it won't even be that long. But once you kind of go in that direction, you can really only, I mean, you can go up to
Japan, cross to Alaska,
or you have to just keep going. So geographically, it puts us in a position where we're getting to be quite far from the United States, which is fine. But in terms of seeing friends and family, it's logistically, it gets harder.
Yeah, so
it gets more expensive, actually. So it's a really big financial question for us. Because also where we'd be cruising first would be the Pacific Islands. And then French Polynesia, and then like eventually it would be like Australia, New Zealand, like places that are just not, people ask us actually sometimes why we cruise where we cruise, and the cost of living in places is a huge consideration for us. So there's the finances of traveling in places, you know, some places that will be more expensive than what we've historically done. And then there's like the cost to get back from these places. And then also in terms of preparing for that kind of passage, we have to have spares of everything, because there's no more Amazon. There's no more, you know, sending packages to our friends and family and picking them up when we get back to the States, and shipping things into a different hemisphere is like a different cost situation. So yeah, the preparation, so the financial aspect that goes into it is big. And then there's the geographical thing. So that's our concern with the Pacific. So the big question though is not whether we're going to do it, it's when we're going to do it. So back to the macro weather thing I was talking about. So you cross the Pacific at the end of March or early April, because that is when the weather is good for sailing across the Pacific. And that is just like, it's out of cyclone season. It's just, that's when everyone does it. That's the best time to do it. Wind is from behind, good conditions. It's supposed to be a really nice ocean. I will let you know.
It's called the peaceful ocean for a reason.
I've been duped before, but it's supposed to be a really good crossing. But yeah, so we either are going to be going in March of 2023 or March of 2024. So that brings us to the, you know, the whole what's going on with what, you know, how we're making the decision and the factors that go into the decision. So if we wait and do it in 2024, we have another 18 months
in the Sea of Cortez.
15 months in the Sea of Cortez, which if you followed us, our channel for a while, or know us personally, we don't really tend to stay in one, like that would be way longer than we've ever stayed anywhere, which is also has its appeal, because, you know, that would be different. And I have family in Arizona, and the Sea of Cortez is amazing. And we've barely scratched the surface because, as I said before, we really only got like 4 weeks of cruising in, which is not that long because of how slow boats move. So to summarize, especially if you're just joining now, our future plans are either crossing the Pacific in March of 2023 or 2024. And if we do it in 2024, we're going to be in the Sea of Cortez, and then we'll probably do other travel. I don't know by boat what that travel may or may not be, but yeah, it's TBD. So let me just go through some comments and see. Let's see.
Shmoop sent us some money. Thanks, Shmoops.
Oh, thanks, Shmoops. Margarita money.
We'll leave that soon.
Or painkiller money. Thank you. Yay, Rocky Point. Okay, you know Rocky Point.
I think someone asked what we need to do to the boat.
That's a really good question. And that's another part of the prep that we have to do.
The boat is out of the water for the first time since January of 2020. And there seem to be quite a few projects to do. Like when I was trying to close the through hulls, we're getting the hull sandblasted right now. So it's going down past barrier coat, which we haven't done yet since we owned the boat. Some of the through hulls are stuck, so they got to be serviced. I noticed our rudder had some play in it. So that means the bushings have to be replaced. I have to drop the rudder while I'm there. So it's going to be some work to get the boat ready.
Yeah. So the first thing we're having done is we're doing the bottom. We're getting the bottom soda blasted because we haven't done it since we owned the boat. And to anyone who doesn't know, we actually bought our boat Calico Skies 11 years ago now. So we bought it in New York when we lived in New York City, and just to sail around. We never thought we'd be cruising in the boat. That's why the boat looks like it does and has everything hanging off the back, because we adapted it over time. Which was a good decision, because that meant that we had paid it off before we left. So we could actually do this at least initially before we started YouTube. And I'm getting distracted, but, yeah. So the first thing we're going to do is soda blast the boat, because, we've never painted the bottom since we owned her down to the barrier coat. We've painted the bottom many times, but we've never taken her down.
Yeah. So we have to see if there's any issues with having the boat with the barrier coat that hasn't been seen. Like, does the hull have any blisters or anything like that? So that might change.
We don't suspect, but
the build's not known for it, but there's a chance there could be things that need to be ground out and re-glassed over too. So that's step one.
Supposed to be happening right now, though we haven't heard from the boatyard, so maybe it's not. But so we're actually going to pay to have that done in Mexico, because it's a really tough job, and not a health, like it's not a good job. But then we're going to paint the bottom. When we get down there. So the first thing we're going to take care of on the boat is all bottom things related, or all things that have to be done while you're hauled out. We're getting, we have new transducers.
Yeah. Cause we've been putting the wine glass in the hull and that's going to be finally fully installed. We have the forward scan.
We're not gonna have going to have a wine glass in the hull to tell us what the depth is anymore. We're going to have an actual depth sounder, and we have a forward facing,
like forward sonar.
Yeah. Because that's going in. Nobody knows this on here, but we hit a rock in Maine. We didn't film it. And yeah, so a forward.
Yeah. Like it's when charts are bad, it'll be helpful for us.
But yeah, so we're thinking long-term Pacific reefs. It'd be an awesome thing to have. I guess the rudder thing that you talked about, the stuffing box.
The stuffing box is leaking. So I have to change that out again.
Was there something with the wheel? Like we wanted to check the underneath.
The whole steering we got to check, I guess. All the systems. If you're crossing the Pacific, we have to go over all those systems. So
the way we'll organize the boat work will be like, we'll do everything that has to be done while we're hauled. And then, you know, we're not going to, since we don't know what we're doing yet, you know, at some point in the next, let's call it 2 months, we'll get the boat back in the water and we'll continue to work on these projects. So we're going to do some while she's hauled out in Mexico, and then, you know, as boat projects go, it'll just be that, you know, yeah. I mean, I think it'd be nice to say we could do everything. It's not that we can't do all the work within 2 months, but it's just that if we need parts and things linger, and I mean, we have quite a big wish list. Like there's things we have to do for a big ocean crossing. And then there's things like our canvas is going on our Bimini and our Dodger. It's really old. We had it restitched in St. Martin 3 years ago, and they said it was on its last legs. So we need to replace that. But the thing is, it's not like we can just replace that, because we also need to do something with our solar panel. So it's possible that we might want to do some type of an arch, which would change the canvas.
Yeah,
stuff.
Well, the davits are really the problem too. Like the davits broke. We broke one davit, which we did a video on, but like one davit arm came out of its bracket, but the second one broke too. So there's definitely some issues there, and I'm seeing the hull is flexing a little bit from all the weight on the davit. So an arch could be better, or I have to get a welder in. So there's some things that need to be done on our davits and stuff like that. So that's a big one. There's some good welders in that yard. So I think we'll take advantage of that. So Calico might be out for a little bit. I don't know. Maybe December, January she goes back in, but I don't see it moving back quickly for us. I think we have a lot of maintenance that's been kind of deferred over the last, well, since
and,
the last
and
2 years.
We also have a lot of like family friend visiting that's been deferred for a long time. So we saw our good friends in New Orleans last week, but there's just a few more people that we really want to see, especially if we might be crossing the Pacific in March, because then we'll be gone, like gone. I'm just going to quickly go through.
Thanks, Jeff, for this money.
Jeff.
Thank you so much.
That's awesome.
We'll buy a painkiller and get this boat show. I saw some people who aren't attending the show are jealous that the painkillers will be flowing soon.
Someone asked Alaska. It's not on the table. The only thing is like Japan is a really expensive place to cruise. And
I think
because we would go there first.
And, yeah, we wouldn't do
and it's
like
not a great place to cruise.
Like we wanted to go up to BC, but I think we've had enough. Like we motored more than we ever motored our entire sailing cruising career up the coast. And I don't know if I have it in me to go up all the way up there that this way. I think if you go like across and around the high pressure, you get into a sailing situation.
Yeah. So for people who don't know, you can't really sail.
Hey, there's Daryl.
The west coast of California.
Someone asked if we're getting new sails.
Yeah.
This is Daryl. He runs Precision Sails, and he's getting us a new spinnaker.
Bombing the chat.
So more people are just arriving at YouTube Central here. So,
This is Daryl, Precision Sails. We have a stay sail from them. And if you've seen our videos, we blew out our spinnaker. So we've been working.
A new one.
Yeah, we've been working with these guys. To do a new one, it's gonna be really nice.
Hey, if anyone could see,
it's gonna be
this is design. We got the logo on there and everything.
That's so exciting! That's amazing.
Yeah,
well, you guys have fun.
Yeah, what are you guys up to?
We're putting Christmas lights out.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, fun!
I know, and there's beer.
Yeah.
You heard it from Daryl.
Thank you.
The festivities have
begun. Yeah, the house is starting to fill in because it's getting close to 5 o'clock. So there'll be more people roaming in the hallways here, I'm sure.
Yes, that will be the case. What is that, a spear gun?
Yeah, I don't know why Jeff has a spear gun. I did see a sail question. That we are getting the spinnaker, which the sails are okay. Like, I don't know. The jib is 2012. The main is 2014. I think the main's in better shape than the jib. They're still holding on.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. That's a good question. Like, if we weren't to cross the Pacific until 2024, we might work on getting new sails. We probably wouldn't have time to do that if we didn't, but we're kind of getting towards the end of the life of our jib in Maine. We're not there yet.
I mean, 10 years is probably a pretty good life for a cruising sail, yeah. And they've done above average miles, probably, especially in the Maine, you know, some better shape. The Maine has been up for a lot of those miles motor sailing, yeah. And we'll talk to Daryl later. Don't worry about it, guys. Maybe we'll figure out a jib or a main.
Yeah, the only thing that works in our favor with not getting new sails, like those sails, is that it's supposed to be, it's a downwind crossing. So we shouldn't really need a stiff main.
No, probably not.
But let me go back up because I want to make sure, we're so grateful you guys are here. We want to make sure we answer questions. Okay, we saw that one. Where's Delos? They're doing a podcast right now.
With 59 North.
Yeah. But they're here.
We saw them last night. Ciara was so happy to see Grace.
I was really happy to see her too. You're both on, Gary and Brooke. Nice. I saw something. I'm in Charlotte, North Carolina.
We're heading to Charlotte next week.
Oh, Mike, I love your dream. You can definitely do it. We have family in Charlotte, actually. We're going to Charlotte next Monday to see Bill's parents. Upcoming boat projects, went through Alaska. I would love to maybe someday. Hi, Don.
Pick something.
The roof. I'm looking at Hawaii. Someone asked, I saw someone asked, see you soon, Ralph. Children? No, we don't plan on having children.
Yeah. Sierra's our adopted child.
Yeah. I would love to have a dog, but
that's kind of hard on a boat, too.
Either. Would you buddy boat with Delos?
Well, that's $1 million question. Everyone's plans are up in the air.
We can't speak for them what their plans are. So
yeah, like we don't. Neither of us really have a decision on that stuff yet. So yeah, it's a big decision to start crossing the Pacific.
Hi from Portugal. We love Portugal. We're actually going to see our really good friends that we cruised with in Portugal tonight. We got to talk about something else. Kind of a painkiller. Shane. Hi, Shane.
You're losing everybody, honey.
Okay, so back to talking about our lives. So. Yeah, I think I was saying before that you can't sail up the west coast of California. I mean, you can. A lot of people do, but it's not a pleasant sail. And definitely in a past life, we wouldn't have even hesitated to do it. Because one option, like if we don't cross the Pacific in 2023 and we put it off to 2024, one option could be going up the coast to BC, which would be amazing. Because we can go up there, we can come down. Like we have enough time, right? We've got 15 months. But yeah, I don't know if we want to do that sale. We've got friends in BC. We might just like fly up there and do some land travel.
Is an RV arriving? I don't know. Does anyone?
Yeah, we just don't know.
Do we have anything else? Any other agenda items for everybody?
Do we have any other agenda items? Not really. I mean, I did want to talk to everyone about Patreon, because it's something that we don't really advertise ever on our videos, mostly because, yeah, we just don't. But to all our patrons that are on right now, we want to just thank you so much for your support. And we also want to let everyone know that over time since starting our channel, we've really put a lot more into Patreon. I think it's just been a natural thing for us because we just love to chat and hang out with you guys. And that's just a personal interest and strength of ours, I guess. We just love being in touch. And for those of you who don't know, or maybe have considered joining Patreon, it's a great way to kind of get more of a regular contact with us, get questions answered, support if you're considering cruising. Just in general, it's like, yeah, we only have so much time. So between YouTube and cruising and social media, we really focus a lot of our energy and our time next to the videos into Patreon. So this is all to say that if you're interested in a behind the scenes type thing, like pictures, posts, videos, updates, stuff like that. Is that Taylor?
No, I just pulled the other part
through. Everyone in the yard?
Yeah, Patreon is just
huge.
It's a great thing to consider, and it is the reason we're here. Without Patreon, we couldn't even be talking about maybe doing the Pacific. So I just wanted to say that, but something's happening. We want to show you guys right now what's happening in Jeff's backyard. So Jeff, the guy who was on here earlier, the man, the myth, the legend, who is running the YouTube part of the boat show, has a lot of YouTubers staying on his property. We're staying in the house with Delos and Monday Never, which is an old sailing channel you guys might know, but people are staying outside in RVs. Last year we had 5 RVs out here. This year we have, I think it's only going to be, well, 3, and then plus Taylor is going to park her.
No, hers isn't coming. Look at the little teardrop. Oh, she's not. You guys see? Is it still on?
It's 2. Who is staying on this property? Jordan, no. We'll TBD on that. We don't remember who's staying in that van. But anyway. Actually, speaking of Jordan.
Oh, buffering. Oh, no. You guys can see the van? Oh, we lost them.
Really?
Oh, well. Let's just ask if there's any questions we should address, because I think we could wrap this thing up, maybe.
Why?
Oh, you're fine. Did you guys see the vans or no? Are we back on? Only the trailer. Oh,
sorry.
Sorry, guys.
Yeah, I'm sorry, guys. The Wi-Fi here. Oh, God,
dang it.
We always have these problems, even when we're not on the boat. Froze up the minute you went outside. Oh, darn. Okay. Well, I'll recap. There's 3 RVs outside. One of them, more staying in. Kaz's mother is here.
One of them, Taylor, staying in.
Taylor from Taylor Travels.
And the third, I don't know.
Boyfriend, Kiki. And the third one, I was just rambling on to say that we don't remember who's staying there. But when Jeff comes back in, we'll let you know. Because I know he's told us. And it's not Jordan.
No, I think Jordan's hanging off Brady.
Yeah, so I don't remember, but
this year is crazy because like so many old friends we're catching up with. So we haven't seen Taylor since the last boat show. Matt and Jessica, we haven't seen. So it's gonna be a lot of fun. It's gonna be a lot of talking, a lot of chatting.
Yeah, sorry guys.
Rocky Point. Oh, Dane, that's the guy who last messaged who messed.
Dane.
Last guy who messaged us. We rolled into Penasco Boatyard in Rocky Point. And he's like, hey, I know you guys from Calico Skies. And then he proceeded to drive us around everywhere.
Yeah.
And go out for beers together and work on the boat. So it's good to see you on here, Dane.
Yeah, there's so many serendipitous things that happen in our life. Because, I mean, we've said this before, but we're not great at planning. And it's often better not to plan. So we met Dane in the boatyard when we hauled Calico Skies in Penasco, and he drove us back and forth to our Airbnb every day. We hung out with him. Yeah, like multiple times a day. He gave us a fan, which saved my life because it was 100 degrees in the boat because you can't run AC. It runs off water. So once the boat was hauled, we had no way to cool down, and we literally had to like attack our to-do list every day. We were on the boat for like two, three hours max every day trying to like get stuff done. And yeah, Dane brought us this massive fan over, and it was, yeah, we had to pickle the water maker and do certain things to leave the boat. So that was, thank you, Dane. That's safe.
Yeah, we made no forward progress on the boat yet. We just took care of the systems that we needed to. Just because it was too hot. Like it was a heat wave the week we were there, and it was just unbearably hot to do any physical labor. It didn't really cool down, but I hear it's cooled off now in Rocky Point, so it should be better when we go back to work.
Yeah. Yeah, it was so hot because, I mean, there's no breeze either in the boatyard, right? It was about 100 inside the boat, and it was so hot that we couldn't even physically get our clothes out from the aft cabin, aka the garage.
My packing list included 2 pairs of board shorts, flip-flops, and t-shirts. I have no jeans, no sneakers.
Yeah, but the funny thing is, because we were here last year, we left a lot of our clothes in Jeff's storage unit, so we were able to just use some of those. And then when we were in New Orleans visiting our friends, well, those friends, the ones that we went buddy boating with when we first quit our jobs, we also left our car in his mother's house. Because we thought we were just going to go cruising for a year, and they actually emptied our car for us, which was full, and our car was full of clothes, New York clothes. So we got some of those from New Orleans because they had them. So we've hodgepodged together an outfit because it was 100 degrees, and then it was 100 degrees in Scottsdale. And here it is like 50 to 60, it's about 60, 65 Fahrenheit. So we're all really cold.
It's like you live in constant air conditioning up north. It's kind of crazy.
Yeah, I'll show you a picture of me on the plane. It's pretty ridiculous. So Michelle, my New Orleans friend, gave me a hat and a whole bunch of other really warm clothes. But that's me
trying to fly
on the plane. That's how cold we are. So greetings from Central Virginia. Oh, hi, George Mean.
Kentucky Derby. That sounds fun.
Thank you, Patrick, for subscribing. That's another thing, I guess, sort of on top of that whole Patreon thing. I was just saying, yeah, if you watch our videos and aren't subscribed, yeah, please subscribe. That really helps. I know you'll hear a lot of YouTubers always saying, like, subscribe.
Click,
like,
why subscribe?
Yeah, but YouTube really rewards that. So, yeah, we really would appreciate that if you could do it. If you are enjoying the videos. Kelly.
What else?
I want to go to the boat show. No, you won't be a stalker, Kelly. Everybody's a stalker. It's all good. No. It's pretty chill, like, for the most part. Unless you're here to see Delos, then it's not chill.
It's a bigger scale.
Yeah, but if you're here to see us, magnitude. It's all good.
We like talking to everybody. That's part of the fun of coming to these shows is the random interactions you have, just walking around Annapolis and stuff like that.
Yeah. I mean, we went to the boat show for 7 straight years when we lived in New York, because back then we had no access to, like, boaters. And it was like before, I guess Brian was making videos, but really it was before, like, YouTube sailing channel was a thing. So we went to the boat show every year just to be close to sailboats. And it's kind of ironic because we didn't really appreciate, you know, the boats that are at the boat show are very expensive, really nice boats. Not really generally the boats that people actually cruise on and live on full time. So it's funny because that's how we started. And yeah, we just met a lot of people that had similar interests, and it was great. I mean,
I think it was our only way to really tie into the sailing community. Like, we weren't sure. Like, it's interesting because our Uber driver flying from New Orleans sailed once, and he's like, "How do you guys break into that world?" Like, he was asking us because he loved to sail, but he doesn't know how to start doing it. But I think for us, it was a big way of connecting to the community was coming to the Annapolis Boat Show every year, because you would talk to people who are aspiring to sail or are sailing, have boats, and it was like a tie into the community. So it is kind of funny going full circle now that we're in this sailboat show. It's something that we used to attend probably 12 times in our lives before this, and now we kind of work with the boat show. So it's kind of gone full circle, which is like a really cool story, sort of. Like, it feels pretty cool to, like, be part of the community that we were so aspiring to be in.
Yeah. So it has a special place in our hearts, which is so funny. Now it's gone full circle and we're actually in a booth at the boat show. It's crazy. I just saw my mom asked, "Is Mikey, do we know when your brother's coming?"
It's coming Friday. My brother's coming to help work the boat show booth. So that's gonna be cool because I haven't seen him since the Panama Canal.
Yep. And then someone else said hi from Ontario.
Someone said nice haircut. So I actually got a real haircut this time.
Yeah, I tried to cut Bill's hair this morning, and it did not go well. I think I'm just used to doing it on the boat. We were outside. The wind was blowing. It was like a hot mess. I kind of made a big cut, like, on this side into his ear. And I was like, we're in society now. Yeah.
I can't do it. Yeah. So we got a real haircut. So yeah. That's the first time we've gotten a real haircut in like 2 years, probably. So
we have a question actually about how,
after the boat show,
what's the plans after the boat show? Yeah, so plans after the boat show, we kind of just to really summarize, we're going to be working on the boat. That's the next thing. So we're going to get back. We're going to see Bill's parents in North Carolina first. Then we're going to go back to Pinasco, Rocky Point.
Arizona, then Pinasco. Well,
yeah, first to Arizona, then back to the boat and painting the bottom and doing the bottom stuff. That's the first thing. I mean, I think we have a list that's 100 things long, honestly.
Yeah, so I think
a list on me.
I don't know if we'll live on the boat or if we'll get an Airbnb or something. Like, that's the other thing. Like, it's a pretty dusty, hot boatyard. I'm not sure. They have some facilities, but I don't know if we'll live on the boat, or we might just find an Airbnb somewhere and commute to the boat and do the work. So it just takes longer if you're not on the boat living, though, because you have to stop them and lights go out. Like, you know, if you live on the boat, a boat, you already crushed through work. But I don't know if we have that in us right now. So we might,
we'll see. Like,
might stay somewhere.
Brian and Kaza have a place till November 9th that we can stay at that has a bunch of bedrooms. We'll probably do that and then figure out what we want to do. So yeah, and then plans post that. I mean, it was a whole long diatribe. We're either crossing the Pacific in 2023 or in 2024. If it's 2024, we're going to cruise to see if we're tested.
Someone says, well, we do a live walk around the boat show. Oh, like live on YouTube.
We wanted to do that.
We considered it. It might be mayhem, though.
I just don't think there's, I think the audio will just be crazy.
Yeah.
I just don't think, I think it'll just not be pleasant.
And people are like, yes.
There was another question that came in that I wanted to, no, not that one. Yeah, someone said we're looking to get a boat and debated hitting the boat show afraid. Yeah. So we, you know, one thing, oh, sorry, I should read the whole comment. We were looking to get a boat and debated hitting the boat show, but are afraid if we would, if we do, we would go from looking at used and then go new, budget breaker. Yeah. So the boat show is all new boats, right? And unless you have the budget for that, a lot of cruisers don't, you're going to be buying a used boat, right? But I will say what's nice about getting on new boats is just to get a feeling for layout and different design considerations, which you can do the same thing by looking at used boats, obviously, but they're all these boats in the same place. So being able to get on each boat and kind of like, walking down the stairs and like feeling things and then going to the next one, it really is kind of good for your mind to kind of get a better like visual understanding of design considerations and maybe what you like or don't like. And I think it's a little different because when you're used boat shopping, you know, the owner kind of lets you on the boat or whatever, shows you around, but at the boat show, you can like open up the drawer. I mean, you can really like, it's a public thing, right? So you can kind of go crazy. I don't know. Bill and I thought that we actually kind of got a lot out of looking
at new boats. We could have, when we were buying a used boat, we could have bought like a Beneteau or a Catalina or a Sabre or.
That's another
good point. So I think we kind of like got a feel for like how the boats are built and manufactured. And I think that was part of why we decided on our boat, even though it's much older than, you know, the new.
Yeah, because you have all these different brands. So if you have no exposure to the brands and it's all new, it's nice to get on different quality boats, different price boats and kind of, yeah. So even though you might not buy a new boat, I don't know. I think so.
It'd be helpful. Someone said buying a used one requires some skill at Boatworks. If you're a fixer, no problem. So it's funny. I've had friends buy new boats that have had a lot of issues that you wouldn't expect. So I almost think the sweet spot is like a boat that is a year or two old and has been used because the new boats come out of the factory and not every system is vetted. It's a boat, so everything's broken anyway. But we've had friends who have chasing maintenance issues the entire way they're sailing around. So yeah. I think the ideal thing, if I had like an unlimited budget, I would pick like a high quality builder. I'd find a boat that has come off a refit or, you know, but has done some like ocean sailing because the systems that are required to cross an ocean are many and expensive. Yeah. And I would find a boat that would have that stuff. I wouldn't get probably a brand new boat.
Yeah, that's a really, really good point. And in terms of kind of learning things, as you know, Bill and I are ex-accountants. So we actually didn't know anything about fixing anything before we got the boat. So, I mean, I don't know if I can say that everyone would be the same, but I think kind of generally speaking, if you're really driven to do something and you have a passion for it, and you surround yourself with a network of people and a community of people who have different skills, then you can learn a lot because, you know, you have to be able to fix everything. And even people who have a background or who are handy at home, like, you know, boats are different too, right? It's just a matter of like, I guess,
learning,
being willing to learn.
Not being afraid.
Yeah.
Just go for it. Dive in. You're going to make mistakes.
Asking for help from people. Okay, so
someone said, someone asked the biggest boat project besides the bottom. I think taking off the rudder is going to be a challenge because I'm pretty sure that's going to be corroded shut. It's a cast aluminum quadrant and stainless steel hardware. And then we have the bronze tiller arm on there for good measure. So I forgot to PB blast all those hardware before I left, which would have been smart to leave penetrating oil on it. So I'm sure I'm going to have a fight trying to get that undone. And then I have to get the boatyard to lift me up and let the rudder drop out. So that'll be a bit of a to-do. The davits, it's not really going
to
be on me.
What did you not need to do? Spray it with PV Blaster?
Yeah, I should have PV Blasted all the hardware.
Well, Dane's there.
Oh,
yeah. Dane, are you still on?
Dane, can you go PV Blast my hardware? That one's big. The davits are going to be a big project. We just don't know what it's going to look like yet. Like, if we're going to build an arch or we're going to try to reinforce what we have. It's not really on me. I don't know how to weld, so that's a new one for us. But we have to do something about that, because when the davit arm broke, we lost a lot of the tension, so everything is more flexible. So we've been seeing the solar panels now going like this, where everything was really tight and nice, but I think once we popped it, it's now a bit looser. So I don't think it would survive a gale. Possibly we might lose a solar panel. So something has to be done to reinforce that, make the boats seaworthy again.
Yeah, and for people who don't know, which is probably most of you, when we bought the boat in New York, we were living in New York, and a Sabre is a very beautiful classic boat. And when we got the davits, our main priority was to have something that didn't take away from the lines of the boat, because we weren't cruising full time. And so we wanted the boat to still be beautiful. So we got the davits with arms that swing and close. So we've adapted those over time.
We put stabilizers on to keep them from swinging.
Yeah.
And then we put new, like, proper block hardware on there, block and tackle. Mm-hmm. And then we added a solar panel. Mm-hmm. And then we added a place to lift the kayak. And it's just become like this Franken davit thing that was working. But now, it lasted a few years.
It worked for a long time. But you'll often see on cruising boats that they have arches and things. And, you know, had we known we would be doing this one day, then we probably would have done something different.
But we definitely would put an arch on.
But at the time, we didn't know. So that's why we have the davits we have. We literally just left New York thinking we'd be gone for 2 years. I know it's kind of confusing because we didn't start our YouTube until later. When we left, we didn't think we'd be.
Yeah, I think our goal was like make St. John and U.S. Virgin Islands, because we went there on a friend's boat. And we're like, that would be really cool if we could pull that off. Mm-hmm. And then it just, I don't know, we just kept going.
Yeah. Hi, Bubba. There was something. I missed the long sailor hair. We liked Bill's hair long. There was someone, but it just, Bill's like a toddler with his hair. He didn't brush it.
Didn't condition it.
Yeah. To this day, I think it's thinned out because of the stress that and trauma the roots were under.
I'll have you know the barber said I had nice hair.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Evan Anderson, I'm so sad I got to see Bill hanging out last year. I rolled past my wheelchair, but this year I have to go to. I'm so sorry, Evan. Wish you could be here, but maybe next year.
That's part of the fun of the boat show, is just randomly saying hi to people.
Yeah.
It's on my iPad.
We still have 20 minutes. Yeah. Well, my mom is asking about Patreon. Yeah. So for people who don't know, Patreon makes a difference is that you can choose to support us by video, right? Or by month.
That's by video.
So it's by video, but you can cap your contribution. So let's say you want to give us $2 a video, but that's still outside your budget or whatever, you don't want to give that much, you can cap it at $2. So you can actually give us $2 for one video per month and get all the benefits to Patreon.
I think
the main reason is
sustainable. Like, the YouTube ad revenues change, it shift all over the place. We don't ever know we're going to make off YouTube, but the patron support we have is what keeps it going every month. We know that's coming in. That's how we keep selling.
Yeah. So the
in a nutshell, Patreon, your mom wanted a quick one.
Patreon support is something we can depend on because we know, you know, when we make this video, we're going to have this level of support. And YouTube is just the Wild West. It's like
the YouTube algorithm is a fickle beast that we have not figured out quite yet. You just don't know what's going to happen on YouTube. So, some videos we think are awesome and they'll get like no views. Some videos we think are not that great and they'll get a ton of views. We can't figure it out.
No. But anyway. So, it's hugely beneficial to us. Evan, I see you Saturday, Travis. Okay. Oh, Norway. Hi.
It's late in Norway.
Seattle boat show. I've never been to Seattle.
I should fly up there.
Yeah. I want to go visit Big Bear in BC. So maybe we'll do that. Thanks, Bob.
What do you want to?
We want a Halberg Grassy. Those are beautiful boats. I think, yeah, if we ever got another boat, that would probably be on the list. And they have them at the boat show. They're very seaworthy boats, a little bit, well, depending on the size, they can be a little bit narrow, but really safe, good cockpits. We're in New York. Well, we lived mostly in Manhattan, although we kind of lived all over. But when we lived in New York, we lived on Calico during the summers. So we would give up our apartments. So to save money on rent, we would live on the boat. And when we were on the boat for those summers, it would be in Long Island, Port Washington.
Yeah, Manhasset Bay. I grew up in Smithtown, kind of. But we kind of moved all over as a kid. And I went to high school in the UK, actually, in England. So I can't really say I have a hometown per se, but my family lived in Smithtown the longest, I'd say.
Yeah, so not upstate. You bought a boat, Franco? That's awesome. Congratulations.
You guys and the crew of Delos and Parley did something in my life. I have bought a boat now. I'm going to start my new travels around the world next month. That's cool.
Woohoo! Nice. Bless you.
COVID.
No. Have you gotten any more rust stains on the dinghy?
Our dinghy's full of rust stains.
Probably.
That's actually, I finally figured out what that is. It's even though the dinghy davits are stainless, it's static electricity activating. And as the dinghy slides slightly against stainless steel when we're moving, it creates little rust stains. It's driving me crazy. I couldn't figure out how rust was coming off something that's not rusty. Someone told me. Yeah. I think it was a YouTube comment.
Thanks, Fluffy Otter.
I don't know. Does anyone else have any? I guess ask questions away, because I think we're going to for our agenda, right?
Yeah, do you guys have any questions for us?
Fire away.
However, how about following videos on YouTube, the amount of followers? Right. Yeah, subscribing is definitely important. I don't think YouTube have gotten their own algorithm. Yeah, that's true.
All right. Thanks.
Hi from Ecuador. Oh, thank you.
Thank you. You've heard, someone says, I'm not a master engineer and worry if I get a boat that I won't be able to fix things on the fly like you and Brian do. Should that deter me from cruising? I would say absolutely not, because I am not an engineer by trade at all. I grew up in a household where my father wasn't very handy, and we paid people to do everything fixing wise. So I came into this with absolutely no background. I tried to change a tire once in my car and I dropped it. Like I don't know what I'm doing with tools. But I think for me, like we bought the boat and we knew we wanted to go cruising. So I spent an entire winter while I was working to put the boat in a shed and kind of just tore it apart and made mistakes and made friends that did have experience and learned from it and kind of took it from there. So I learned a ton from Brian because he's an electrical engineer. You know, I learned a lot from all my friends who are engineers, but I don't have that background, but I could figure it out now for mostly.
I was just telling our Uber driver, the one that said he loves sailing, that in New Orleans, that when we first got the boat, we paid someone to do everything. And I remember we loved our engine mechanic, Guido. He was such a great guy. And we asked him one time if we could film everything he did to change the filters, right?
It's simple. It's an oil change.
It's only an oil change,
but I didn't know how to do that.
So he was explaining it to Bill and I was videoing it. And then we would watch the video after, because you know he let us do that. And so really over time, we learned how to do things and we surrounded ourselves by people who had boats. We made friends with them and then we kind of shadowed them. And then we got them on our boat to look at things. And yeah, I mean, I don't watch YouTube videos, but I know that could be a very helpful resource for learning how to fix things. But I actually think the community is really a powerful thing, right? Because that's the way boaters are. Like if you buy a boat, you're just not alone, you know? And I guess granted, a lot of people are going to pay to have things done, but not cruisers. Like full-time cruisers or people who are planning to cruise, they're going to be doing everything themselves and trying to learn. So I'd say most of the systems are pretty simple on a boat too. Like in terms of maintaining systems, like maybe not putting in an arch or like fiberglass work, but like the everyday stuff you need to learn. I mean, I don't know. I guess you're the one who does everything, not me. But I think we're trying to say is don't let that deter you. We really don't think that should deter you.
No, I think if you're determined enough, you could do it. I think it's just, yeah. You know, you just have to. It's a real pain in the butt. Like you don't want to have to fix everything, you know, but it becomes, you just do it. I mean, it's a really painful process to become like candy, quote unquote, but I'm happy I did it, and it's changed my viewpoint on a lot of things I do now, because I could be around my parents. I'm like, I could fix that. I could definitely do something there. And I didn't have that skill before. So it's just, you become like a MacGyver living on a sailboat.
And I think it's funny, because I actually think the most important thing you need to do this, beyond money, beyond ability, anything like that, is actually, hi Cam, is the passion. It sounds really silly, but the thing is, if you really want to do something badly enough, things will just fall into place, and you will think that is stronger than you think it is. And I think it's funny, because people who love boats and like love sailing and really want to do this don't realize that not everybody does. Even a lot of people who watch us don't really want to do it themselves, right? So there's really only a small portion of people that actually want to be living on a boat full time. It just feels like that's not the case, because you want it so badly, but believe me, not everybody really wants to do what we're doing. So if you want to do it, I'd say that's pretty much a lot of what you need to make it happen. Because as you guys know, it is not easy all the time, right? It's just a choice that we've made. So yeah, I think to the people who want to do it, it seems like this magical paradise thing that they can't attain. But in actuality, that's not the case at all. It's just a very different life with different ups and downs and pros and cons. So if you want to do it,
you're definitely capable of doing it.
Do not let that deter you. And there was another question that came in a little further back. Dane had a good question. Do you miss land life? That's always a good question. And the answer is actually no, we don't really miss land life. I will say, I mean, it's really convenient and it's a really nice change. We were using our friend's air fryer in New Orleans, and I want to buy one for the boat.
Air fryers are a pretty amazing piece of machinery. We haven't encountered that one before. It's pretty cool.
Yeah. We come back from the boat and into society, you know, every once in a while, there's all these new appliances. Like, it's like 10 times harder to use a coffee machine because they just get more complicated. And it's very overwhelming. It's very different from our life. We love the simplicity of our life, but it is really awesome to experience the convenience. But I think the biggest problem with land life for us is actually just not having enough regular access to nature. Because when you live outside, you get used to it, like body, mind, and soul. And then you feel like Cameron just came home, Jeff's wife, and you just can't adapt. It's like I have to get outside and be in the sun. So obviously I could adapt, but I don't want to. We don't miss the conveniences enough that we're like, oh, we'd rather be on land. But yes. Yeah, I don't know if that's a good answer, but hey Cam.
Hi.
Jeff's wife just got home, Miss Cameron.
How are you talking?
We're on a live
ourselves.
Stream.
This is what we do. We just talk to the computer for fun. Yeah. We just like watch ourselves this little camera, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, say hi. So say hi to everybody.
This is Cameron. Hi. This is Jeff's wife.
Hi.
She is the wife of the man, the myth, the legend, who's, yeah.
They're both hosting us all
here,
which is really cool.
They're hosting us here, though. Yeah, they're incredible hosts. We love their house.
We should have owned a new shirt, too, we made.
Oh, yeah. You're wearing it.
Yeah, perfect.
Yeah.
So,
this is our shirt. The woman who designed it is actually the same one who designed Bill's tattoo. It took a while to get it to exactly where we wanted it, but we're very proud of it, and we love the way it came out. People might point out that we're not going to have the same spinnaker down the line. So we do realize that will change.
Yeah. Like, it's funny. We made it and we got a new spinnaker.
Our new spinnaker is going to have the same colors, but regardless of that, it's an amazing design. We love this shirt. I think this is our favorite shirt we've ever done, and it's on the shop. We just haven't had time to take pictures and advertise it.
Yeah. Well, we just got them last week or 2 weeks ago. Yeah. We came to Arizona because we weren't sure what they looked like. So we didn't want to like throw it out there yet, but it's pretty cool. The same nice fabric that we had. It just has a sweet spinnaker sailing boat on it.
Yeah. I love that one. I have one to wear at the show. Do you guys always buddy boat? We always buddy boat. The thing about boating is that we don't necessarily do every single thing together. Like, you know, we'll go to an anchorage a few days before Delos and then they'll come, or they might want to check something out that we're not interested in. Like, we often, because I mean, when you watch a YouTube video, that's like 0.000% of our life, right? Because it's 20 minutes. So, you know, there's other things going on where we're, you know, not always together, but we always do cruise with buddy boats because Bill's very social, more so than me. And we just love to have friends. So we're not the type of people who just kind of like want to be alone on a boat. And I think there are a lot of those people out here.
Yeah, but it's not for us. Like for me, the community is the most important thing of the sailing.
Yeah.
So I remember when I single-handed the boat in the Caribbean, my claim to fame is that I didn't go a single night eating dinner by myself because I always had friends or someone in network I could go with because Grace was in New York. So for me, but we don't travel like, you know, we don't really, it's not like you have like a meeting in a powwow and say, hey, we should go here tomorrow or something. It's a little more fluid than that. And then if we're on passage, it's very much like everyone sails their own course. Like we won't hang out or like you sail the boat as fast and safe as you can. And you just meet up whenever you meet up.
Yeah.
And you don't often know where you're going. Be like, oh, maybe we'll see you in the same anchorage because every boat is different. You might have breakdown. So it just kind of happens naturally.
And I do think kind of going back to the little speech I gave about not being able to fix things deter you. I do think that on land, people are very much more siloed. You have your family and friends support, but it's often from a distance. One of the things we love about the cruising community is that it's one big family. And for us, you know, everyone has your strengths and weaknesses. It's become Bill's strength, fixing things, but it wasn't always, right? So we had a need to surround ourselves by people too, that, you know, in a group, everyone's going to like certain things or be good at certain things. So one of the things we're not great at is like planning, which is more so because we're very flexible about where we want to go. We're not like when we go on vacation, we're not those people who want to see the things you're supposed to see when you're somewhere kind of thing. But it's great to be with people who are like that because they can be like, you guys, we're going to go do this and you want to do it. Like, trust me, you want to do this and then we'll go do it. So what I'm trying to say is that the team aspect of cruising is important to us for our ability to do it, I think, and thrive and enjoy ourselves. So,
I mean, you wouldn't believe how many parts like we wouldn't have, or like if you have like a few cruising boats together, I feel like someone will have the part to fix almost anything, but it's so hard to have everything by yourself. So it's one big community of people that could help each other out and problem
and
solve.
I mean, it's more fun. And it's, I mean, like we can watch Sierra. So Brian and Kaza can go diving and we love Sierra because we don't have kids. So she's like our kid. And so it's on all these levels, like sharing things. It's just better. Like you just get more, right? So we will always have buddy boats.
I love these comments. The shirt is going to become vintage because a new sale is coming.
Oh,
that's a good way to market it. That's pretty smart. A couple people have said that already. Like, oh, limited edition. The new Spinnaker's coming, guys.
That's true, actually, because it wouldn't be that hard to change
the sale only on the
Lotus. New one.
Yeah.
Which we'll probably do in like 5 years. That's how long it takes to make merchandise.
Beautiful shirt. Usually more stuff on your deck and cockpit than that.
Yeah,
yeah, that was an artistic representation. It's not actually what the boat looks like.
Artistic rendering.
Artistic rendering. The boat definitely still has all the stuff on it. Don't worry. Oh, my mom says hi, you too. So both their moms on. That's cool.
So Bill's mother's name is Grace.
My dad's name is Bill.
And he's a third.
Third.
So his parents are Bill and Grace, and we're Bill and Grace. Take from that what you will.
Nay.
Why not just get a tattoo of the shirt and save yourself from everything?
Don't tell my mother if I get a tattoo. She's on the thing listening.
No, we're not allowed to get any more tattoos. My wife is 11 years. Yeah. So Tim saying, you know, he's ready to cruise. His wife's not ready. We meet people like that all the time, whether it's like one has a job they don't want to leave. Maybe it's family they don't want to leave, grandkids, whatever. And that is one of the reasons why we're doing this now, even though, for example, like financially, it's probably not the smartest choice because it's so hard to get two people lined up and in the same mindset at the right time. That's actually, that's a hard thing to overcome with cruising.
You can't will your way into that one.
Yeah.
It just has to kind of work out.
If your partner doesn't want to do it, that is hard. But actually, I don't have time to go down this whole rabbit hole right now, but Bill quit his job before I did, a whole year before I did, actually, because I wasn't ready to quit my job. I had a very good job and I had been there 10 years, and it was much harder for me to close down my land life than it was for Bill. Bill was miserable in New York, which you guys can imagine, you know, it's not shocking.
I'm not an office person.
I was not miserable. So for me, I had a partner that really wanted to do this, and I was more like, well, yeah, you know, but not as motivated to actually make the steps to do it. So if you have a partner that's not quite ready or not there, maybe try to expose them to things that you can that are sailing life related, whether it's going to a boat show, meeting people in the community, you know, stuff like that, to try to get them more excited. And then, yeah, there's other ways to get access to cruising life type stuff. You don't have to be a cruiser. But that is a challenge. Yeah. So I'm sorry. I feel you on that one. We feel very blessed that we both want to do this and we're both in the same mindset at the same time because, yeah, life changes. And we didn't say thank you for people who've given us money. I see a 50 here. That's so kind. Thank you so much.
And Obi too.
And Obi, thank you.
Said buy Gary a drink. There's no chance. I will. Someone loved the TTYC shirt. Still the favorite, Ron.
I like the TTYC one too.
It's harder because that was a specific time in our cruising, and we just wanted to move on and get another shirt. But we still have it on the shop.
Yeah, Travis, will you have merch at the show? No. There's a bunch of reasons for that. It was hard logistically to figure it out. And so right now our merchandise, we use Printful, which is a print on demand service, because we just don't have like the capacity to like financially or physically to like store shirts or buy them in advance. So we couldn't have them at the show, but they're on our store website. So yeah, you have to get them that way. I'm sorry.
We did get a Starlink that's sitting in Arizona. We haven't tried it yet. But we know in Mexico, it is quite quick. Like we could upload a video either via Dallas's Dome, would take like 3 or 4 hours, and Starlink was about 20 minutes or 30 minutes. So yeah. It's very fast right now. That might change as like more boats get Starlink or more users come online. But right now it is blazing fast.
Mm-hmm. Bill, how'd you go to high school in UK?
My dad got a job and we were expats there. So when I was 16 years old, I moved to England. And I spent 2 years there, and then I graduated and moved back to the States for college to New York.
Someone asked, do you miss indoor plumbing? You know, living on a boat, Kevin, it's been such a, I have like a very scientific type of mind. It's been such an experiment in adaptability and like what you can adapt to. And I can honestly say we don't really miss indoor plumbing. Particularly with respect to like hot showers, which I know sounds crazy.
But Grace does miss the flush handle.
I absolutely
like she does
miss
not like
flush
pumping
toilets.
The head.
I
she likes
hate flushing the toilet.
So that's one thing she doesn't miss for indoor plumbing.
And I will say, doing dishes on land is a pleasure. And I don't like doing dishes, but the fact that you can leave the water running and you have the water pressure to get that food off is incredible. But what we do to compensate for that is like eating and cleaning is not a big part of our life. So I try to explain this to people, like it's because it sounds crazy, but like eating was such a big part of my life, like on land, like it was just such a thing. Like you come home, you make dinner and like, that's just, but we're so active. Every day we're doing something different. Like often at dinner time, we're on the beach or we're like doing something that we eat a little bit more to live instead of live to eat, which says a lot for someone like me, because I was a big foodie. So like dishes and stuff, you know, we just don't make things that like make too many dishes, you know? So we work around the fact that our plumbing is very different from a house. And the bottom line is that we ultimately don't miss it enough that we would rather be having the indoor plumbing. I mean, there's definitely moments where
Who did we buddy boat with prior to the Bahamas? So quite a few actually, but our good friends Brian and Stephanie are actually in Annapolis, and we haven't seen them since Europe. So we were in Europe with them, we were in the Caribbean with them, we were in Bermuda with them. So they're here in Annapolis. We're really excited to catch up with them.
We buddy boated with MJ Sailing for a while.
We did MJ Sailing for a while in the Caribbean. We crossed the Atlantic together to the Azores, so we hung out in the Azores. Mm-hmm. So they were buddy boats, and then Chris and Michelle, who we just saw in New Orleans,
yeah,
in
so
the Bahamas.
Chris and Michelle do not have a YouTube channel, and they're not cruising anymore. They're our New Orleans friends that left New York with us 7 years ago. We all quit our jobs together. How fun is that for all four of us? They were best friends in New York. They have a Catalina 34. Four. So we all left New York together and went down to the Bahamas. And then Bill and I kept sailing and they went back.
And then there's Big Bear, and he just bought a piece of property in BC, but he's still living on the boat.
Big Bear is a good friend.
So those
we
are our main
for
like,
years
we had,
him. But... And he's starting a YouTube channel, but he doesn't have one right now. He's working on building a yurt in BC. Right now.
Off-grid living.
Who else have we cruised with that like people would know?
I'll chat with you on Patreon. Let's see.
I think that's all I can think of at the top of my head.
Hit like make it spike. Beverly Hillbilly Sailing. Yeah, we've been called. We like that too. Take the
wife on charter and work the buddy boat action. Yeah, that's a good idea if you want to get your partner to go cruising. The only thing is the sailing will never be like that again, but You guys are awesome. Thank you. How is world weather impacting on the community? Well, that's a very subjective question, sort of, Jim, but I will say, since we've started cruising, so when we cross oceans, for example, we use historical data that's been collected over the past 100 years. We don't analyze it ourselves, but there's books that gather that data, and you look at that and you're like, okay, hurricanes are always here during this time of the year, so we don't go there. Since we've started cruising, the boundaries of where those hurricanes are supposed to be and not supposed to be at different times have been bleeding over, for whatever reason.
It's become more exaggerated, I guess.
Yeah. Time. So 3 years ago when we were in Nova Scotia, they had their first hurricane in 100 years while we were there. You know, whether this is just like patterns over thousands of years and we're there, or whether it's change or whatever it is. Yes. Yeah, since we've left to go cruising, everything is more dramatic, and we have to stay closer, like more narrow. We can't push the boundaries of where we're supposed to be at any given time as much as people did in the past. And I personally think if that continues as a trend, you know, one day it could be a lot more riskier to do what we do, because yeah, when you're going to do a 3-week crossing, you don't have a weather forecast for that time. You're relying on, hey, we never get storms in June. That's what you're relying on. So yeah, there has been shifts with that for sure.
How do you handle trash buildup on the boat? So it really depends where we are. If we're in a place of garbage, we just throw it out. Like if we're in a civilization, if we're somewhere like the San Blas, we'll actually burn as much as we can. So metal won't burn. So we collect all the cans and glass, but like anything that we could burn that will go away and break down, we usually burn it. Mm-hmm. For crossing an ocean, a lot of it goes in the ocean. You know, like when you're in deep, deep water, food goes overboard. We break the bottles, but we'll never plastic will go in the water. But
yeah, and also like, so instead of food shopping regularly like you would on land, we provision for an extended period of time. And when we buy all that food, we remove all the plastic, all the cardboard. So we're already working with less garbage, like on the boat.
Yeah, we scrap everything for bug purposes too, like all the cardboard. Like nothing really comes on board the boat except what's really needed.
What's our scariest moment on sea?
Scariest moment at sea. I think when we were in a gale in the Gulf Stream and dawn had come, we've been down below locked in, the board's locked, so we couldn't fall overboard or get water in the boat. And I popped my head out the hatch and the boat was like down this angle. Like the bow is going to catch on a wave. And I was like, oh shit. And Grace's like, you can't say, oh shit. But we were just going too fast. And it looked like the bow was going to grab and like kind of pitch, because we were in a Gulf Stream. So the waves are very close together. And we looked at a NOAA weather buoy and they were 22 feet at that point. Like when we looked at the NOAA weather buoy. So they were very steep 22 footers and it was scary. But once we slowed the boat down, it was much more in control. Like we were just going 7-8 knots. It was too fast for those waves. We didn't know at night.
Yeah. I think my scariest moment at sea was when we were crossing the Atlantic Ocean coming back from Spain to go to the Caribbean. We had a crash
jibe,
and then our mast started making a different creaking noise. And then about 2 or 3 days after we had the crash jibe, I was on watch in the middle of the night, and there's these things called shims. They're just wooden pegs that go around the mast on the outside.
Where it passes through the deck.
Where it passes. So there's a hole in the deck where the mast comes out, and then there's these wooden things, pegs that go around. And I was on watch, and all of a sudden I heard like this really awful like pop sound, and all this, the sound of like something hitting the ground. So I turned on the light down below and I saw all those shims on the floor, and the mast was like swaying in the collar. Like from down below inside the boat, I could see the mast moving, and we were how many thousands of miles offshore at that point?
I think we were 1,000 from the Canaries and 2,000 Caribbean, but you're not going upwind against 1,000 miles against those waves and 25 knots of wind.
So that was really scary. But a very long story short, the shims are not structural to the mast. They're kind of just like...
And the masts are very... Like, you'd be surprised when a mast is out of the boat how flexible it is. So the aluminum is like... It's like a noodle. Like, if you put on the stands, you shake it, it'll ripple through.
Yeah.
The wire is what keeps it still and the shims. So
we sat-phoned our rigger, and he was like, get a flip-flop and just stick them in around the mast. Like,
knock something in to keep it from moving so you don't destroy the fiberglass collar on the boat.
And then we had to get it, like, you know, checked and fixed when we got in.
Yeah, we took care of it.
Okay, so we're running out of time, but
trash buildup.
Thank you. I'm glad we inspire you, Donna, is Plucky as well. Plucky's an interesting guy because he has a bit of a persona that he kind of puts on. I mean, in life too, not just on YouTube, but he's a really sweet guy. Like, he's very generous and has like a big heart.
And he's also like, I never would have guessed he's a professional engineer and a lawyer. Like, yeah. I was like from the YouTube videos, you know, the guy, he's a very intelligent, sweet, kind of, he's really, really liked him, like really good company. Yeah.
And I think that persona does kind of come down a little bit when you start to get to know him more. So yeah, he's going to be here at the boat show.
Yeah. He's going to like be the first one to jump in the water to boat show, I guarantee you.
Yeah. I mean, he's definitely wild.
Does anyone cruise alone? Yeah. Lots of people cruise alone.
Yeah.
It's a preference. Some people, I meet lots of single handers who are just hanging out in Anchorage by themselves and they're happy to do so. Anything else?
When are you guys back to sailing? Let's call it 2 months, but we really have no idea.
The boat might not be in the water.
How much sunscreen do you got? Well, we don't wear that much on our bodies, which is not good, but we wear a lot on our face. Well, I do. Bill's getting more in training with the sunscreen.
I do wear rash guard a lot,
but we wear rash guards and stuff when we swim. Your marriage is inspiring. It must take lots of patience and communication. Thank you. It does. It really does. You don't always get to see that stuff on the video. People ask us, like a lot of people are, I think, a little bit suspicious as to how authentic YouTube videos are. And the thing is, they're authentic, but I mean, it's just hard to actually film. Like when you're fighting with your spouse, like you're not going to pick up a camera, right? And anytime we're interacting together, we don't have someone to film that.
We're just talking to ourselves over here.
Hi. So we're never like in the same frame at the same time. So in terms of like authenticity, like, yeah, you don't get that stuff on film very much. So we do fight. We just don't film it. But yeah, we don't really fight like that.
No.
Okay.
You have squabbles every now and then.
Yeah. I'm okay. How much sunscreen do you guys? Yeah, we got
Why
that.
The tattoo?
Why the tattoo? It's a good question.
My mom's on
for
here. I'm sure she'd love to answer that.
They'd love to know why Bill got a tattoo. But you have a good reason for why you got a tattoo.
Yeah, because my grandfather got it. And my grandfather had an anchor, and I don't know, he taught me how to sail. And
you from ocean. So every time you sail a certain amount of miles, you're supposed to get a swallow. And it's 5,000 miles, you get a swallow. So Bill sailed 5,000 miles. And he always wanted, he kind of felt like when we crossed the Panama Canal, it was an end of a chapter. Like we left the Atlantic side and like went on to our new adventures on the Pacific side. And it was just the timing was really good to like memorialize that. And yeah, when you meet a tattoo artist, it's as good as the one that we met that like wants to give you a free tattoo.
Yeah, we wouldn't have paid for it. Like, you know, it was just sort of a serendipitous moment there. Tattoo, big, how big boats to single, how big is a boat single handers can do? I don't know. I mean, I think bigger boats are easier in some ways because everything's slower. The motion's slower. Things go on slower. It's hard with load. So everything on a bigger boat is typically electric. So if you're single handed, you can still do it, like electric halyard winches and electric winches. But if that stuff breaks or you get into trouble, it becomes more complicated. But I'd be happy to single hand mid 40s or 50. I think I could do it if I had to like move a head sail that weighs 300 pounds, then you're in trouble. But I think if everything works, you're okay.
Yeah. I'd probably say like, ideally, if you're going to be doing like a lot of like ocean crossing and a lot of sailing, it's probably better not to have a bigger boat just because of the things Bill's talking about.
By yourself. Yeah.
By yourself. But it's certainly possible.
How do we sail at night if alone? When I single hand a boat alone, I set an alarm every 20 minutes and I just get up and check the radar and AIS and pick my head out. It's not that much fun, but you do get used to it. You know, you get used to that level of sleep and you just kind of learn how to nap, but it's not an easy process.
Captain Breon. Yeah, I think Brian and Kaza, after their podcast, we're going to go visit Papadello's, who's in town. So they're not going to be back for a bit.
Someone saying we should do like a sailing doodles flotilla in the Abaco, charter a few boats and have people come. That would be fun. Like have like a flotilla party. That'd be pretty fun. I'd have fun at that.
Thanks, Evan, for the congrats on the 35,000.
Yeah.
How long did it take for you to find your boat?
A couple months.
Not that long.
We weren't planning on sailing it around the world or anything. So we just thought it was going to be like a fun New York City summer place to live.
Yeah. Bill knew he wanted a Sabre. I had never sailed on a boat before when we got our boat. So that was like all his decision, but he knew that he wanted a strong boat. and a fast boat.
Yeah, the Saber sails really well. That was my biggest like thing I wanted. It was like a well-performing boat.
Yeah, at the time that we bought the boat, he was racing. So he had in his mindset like that he wanted a really fast boat, which has come back to be a fantastic decision with cruising because there's actually not that much wind in the world, it turns out. And we're often sailing in light wind conditions. And that's where our boat really, I mean, our boat does well in heavy conditions too, but yeah, I think sailability is kind of like hugely underrated because it's sometimes hard to get a cruising boat that can also sail really well. But it's actually like a safety thing. And it's like, yeah.
Would we buy a Saber again? Yeah, we definitely would. We definitely would buy a Saber again.
That's probably what we would
get. We would probably look at like a 42 foot Saber or something. We'd be like pretty satisfied. We'd be really happy about that. Mm-hmm. Let's see. How much longer do you plan to film the channel? Well, I'm probably filming the channel as long as we're sailing. And we don't really know.
Yeah.
I don't really know when we'll stop sailing. So it's sort of open-ended.
Yeah. Bill really wants to circumnavigate.
I would like to. I mean, it's definitely on my list at some point in my life. It might not be this round, but
slightly less passionate about circumnavigating, but my passion kind of ebbs and flows more with like how passages have been lately. Whereas Bill, like that's just a thing for him. That's definitely like a life goal. And he would like to do it on Calico Skies ideally.
Well, I think like for proper circumnavigation, it should be on the same boat. You know, so you'd have to restart somewhere, you know, like we've already come this far.
This is what he says to me whenever I'm like, we get a bigger boat.
No, I already sailed 35,000 miles on this boat.
Yeah. So yeah, we'll be sailing and making videos for the, indefinitely. And I guess, I think what we'll do is at the show, we'll try and take some, little just quick videos for you guys and post them on Instagram. I know not everybody's on Instagram. We like did some YouTube shorts and that did not go well. So we're not doing those. But yeah, if you're on Instagram, we'll post some videos of the show. The show really doesn't get underway until Thursday. So that's when stuff's going to happen.
Yeah, it's the VIP day. We could also post to a WhatsApp group we have. We started a WhatsApp group for our patrons. We'll probably put some videos in there.
That's a good question. If money was not involved with the boat.
I don't know what I don't know if it'd be a catamaran. I think it'd be a big mono, like an oyster or halberd grassy or something.
You know what I was gonna say is Big Bear's the Garcia.
Oh, like aluminum? You go like an aluminum, like a big Allure or a big like Garcia. They're cool too, like an expedition yacht. It'd be really sweet. So you could really go far north and it could be insulated and heated. And
there's a boat that I fell in love with at the boat show years ago, which is a Canadian built boat called a Gazard. I don't know if I'm pronouncing that right, but I like those salty boats that have like the bows that kind of come. Like the bow and the stern that like come up, like those big, heavy, salty boats. That was an absolutely beautiful boat. That was a very expensive boat. But yeah, I don't think we would go to a catamaran.
I don't know why. A gunboat.
The type of people who probably would do great on catamarans because we have so much stuff.
Well, they don't like weight though either. So
yeah, but I get seasick and I've been on a catamaran a couple times. And I probably would adjust to the motion, but I kind of like the motion of a monohull. Because even when it's rough, it's just the nature of the design. Like it, yeah, it's like I get more seasick on the dinghy than I do on Calico Skies generally, which is crazy.
Buddy boat beard growth race. Yes, the barber took my beard quite down. We'll see in a couple days.
Our trimmer wasn't working and we had to get cleaned up for the live stream for the show. So we went to go trim Bill's beard and it didn't work. So we were just like, yeah, I told him to get it done and they went a little too short, but it'll be back in like 2 days.
Shame.
Gunboats are nice.
I guess that's probably about it, right?
Yeah. I think we're going to close it up, guys. If you don't have any last minute burning questions.
It's been an hour and 20 minutes. It's been good.
But we love chatting with you guys. And I know that, yes, I've had land sickness. I actually think since I've been doing this for so long, on some deep level, I've gotten a lot more adjusted to motion in general because I don't get it anymore. But I used to get land sick when I got off the boat. Yeah, because I'd be so adjusted to the motion of the boat. Yeah, we love chatting with you guys. And I know we haven't done the last live stream for like 6 months. I don't really know how that happened because we usually try to do a live stream a few times a year.
I think it's been a pretty hectic period for us. Like it was just so much. I mean, 3,000 miles the way we did it with dodging hurricanes and motoring so much, is it's just been kind of a lot of travel for the last few months. So it should slow down a little bit in the Sea Cortez unless we decide to go.
Yeah. Well, it's either going to accelerate or it's going to slow down, depending on whether what we decide to do with the specific crossing. Dane wants to know whether you bought a belt. No, he didn't buy a belt.
My jeans are falling down last night.
We really need to buy a belt. Oh, that's a good question. How far on average are your videos shared in time? So usually there's like a 2 to 3 month lag. Right now, our next video that comes out, because we got COVID for a month, we're still in August in our video. So it's October, August, September. Yeah. So we're like July, August. So yeah, it's like almost 3 months.
But we did nothing for a month because we were sick. So
behind.
We'll probably be 2 months behind soon.
Yeah.
We'll probably skip over an entire chapter because we didn't do much but lay in a boat and air conditioning and try to get better.
Yeah. Yeah. So basically where the videos are going to be now is starting our Sea of Cortez cruising. So yeah.
Ron wants to know, will there be boatyard videos? Yeah, we'll definitely take videos of the boatyard. I think it should be interesting content. Yeah,
there's going to be a lot of boat content coming up.
Yeah, I think it's going to be a lot. It's going to be a period
of
a refit.
Can you tell I'm excited? it's not my favorite thing to edit.
Yeah. I'll help her with that. How do we get internet? I mean, right now, honestly, it's One Life has a Starlink and Dell's has Viasat. There's absolutely no cell service in Sea Cortez.
Starlink.
But we bought a Starlink, so bring it down with us.
Saved our life. Everyone has a Starlink in the Sea of Cortez. We were like, how does everyone have one? And we have a YouTube channel and we don't have one.
I think everyone came from California and it was a viable thing. And
yeah,
we dismissed a boat because we were traveling. Yeah, I guess that's it. So anyone else, Soft Shackle? Yeah, I think that's it. So I think.
How the heck did you get COVID? Nobody knows how we got it from Brian's circumnavigation party.
No, we had it before. We had it first.
Oh, yeah, you're right.
Yeah, I don't know how we got it.
Yeah, we don't know how we got COVID. Never mind.
So yeah, I guess we'll see you guys all. Anyone who's in Annapolis, will see you at the boat show, and everyone else will see you on Sunday. A video is going out.
Yeah, we got another video going out Sunday, which is the only video we have done. We're never done our videos in advance. To anyone who's wondering, never, ever, never have an extra one done. And yeah, so anyway, that's going out Sunday. And that is a fun cruising video. Anchor life video from back in Mexico just before we got to the Sea of Cortez.
George Bean said we live streamed from the canal. I forgot about that. That was March.
Yeah.
I forgot we did. That was good.
March. So that was
6 months ago.
Yeah, like 6 months. I think YouTube told me it was like 6 months ago. Yeah. Yeah. So we'll put out some videos this week of the boat show if you guys follow us on YouTube. And we just want to say thank you for watching our videos. Thank you for all your comments and your support, and for our patrons. Thank you. And for those of you who are unfamiliar with Patreon, haven't checked out Patreon or haven't considered it, I highly advise you do. You'll be surprised. I think you'll be surprised about how awesome it is, because yeah, again, we really focus a lot of our whatever time we have on Patreon because it's so critical to us, and also because we really, really do enjoy it. So please do that. And yeah, we'll see.
Should we do the click, like, subscribe?
Yeah, because we never say
we never
click, like,
that.
Subscribe. So yes, also subscribe. That's unfortunately really important. But yeah, we love you guys. And we truly cannot thank you enough for being interested in us and our journey and watching and supporting. Thank you. And we'll see you out in YouTube land and social media land. Bye.
Adios, guys.
Thanks for joining.